Good morning, everybody. We're going to sing a very familiar song this morning to start off our service entitled, How Great Thou Art. Most of us have sung this song since we were little kids. But I just found out here recently that this song literally comes from all over the world. In 1855, a Swedish minister by the name of Carl Boberg sat down and wrote a poem. And then a couple of years later, he was surprised to hear that poem put to music, to an old Swedish melody. And then a few years after that, there was an English missionary who was ministering in some of those old Soviet satellite countries, Romania, Czechoslovakia, so forth and so on. And he heard the song being sung, and he loved it so much, he thought, I'm going to try to improve on it a little bit. So he took the words and he changed them, changed the tune just a little bit. And he said that the first verse was inspired by a thunderstorm that he experienced in a Carpathian village up in the mountains. The second verse was inspired by some birds that he heard singing along the border of Romania. The third verse was inspired as he saw Carpathian mountain dwellers coming to faith in Christ. And then the fourth verse was inspired when he got back to Great Britain. And then a number of years later, there was another fellow in India who heard that song being sung. And he loved it so much, he brought it back to America. He introduced it at a conference, and from there it was published and it began to spread. And of course, you know that George Beverly Shea and the Billy Graham Association made this song wildly popular. It's a great song that worships and praises our great God. So why don't you stand? Let's sing How Great Thou Art.
Take me home, what joy shall fill my heart.
may be seated.
You know, it works for every other lay leader. Their mic works. I come up here and they shut me off. As I was saying, I actually have notes this morning. A lesser guy would fail. Now it's really going to be something. I have Far Side calendar, but I have notes on the back of them. And if you know me very well, I never take notes. So this week has been mind-blowing. My mind is blown, and it has nothing to do with my mother-in-law passing away. But my wife has been gone a week, so that tells you I have a little time to think, which I don't do very often. But I was in the tractor listening to Focus on the Family, I think it was Tuesday, and they had Lee Strobel on. And Lee Strobel is totally not what I get into because he's into details and figuring stuff out. I'm just the close enough kind of guy. I don't really care. But a few things he said really hit me. One thing he was talking about that he said, some expert, internet expert told him, that do you know that 200 times a second there are people searching if God is real? 200 times a second in the world on the internet, on the search engines, people are seeking, which is that mind-blowing in itself. Doesn't people know God's real? And the other thing was, he said that, another guy, teens are coming to Christ more in the last 3 years than in the last 8 years combined. That's pretty encouraging. And then he got into real mind-blowing stuff about whether the world is created. I'll just go. He talked about the force of gravity. So if you talk about gravity force and you measure it on a line, it's like 200 billion light years long, and you break that down in one inch increments. The range of gravity. A 1%, 1 inch change in gravity, and the Earth wouldn't even exist. 1 inch on 200 billion light years length. I mean, that's pretty precise, isn't it? And then, this I don't even understand, but it sounded pretty good. The ratio of electromagnetic force to gravitational force, maybe some of you know what that means. It's one part to 10,000 trillion trillion trillion. So, that's whatever that is, but it's impressive. But to know what that is, even more will blow your mind. So he said, you take the North America continent, the size of the North America continent, and you stack it full of dimes reaching to the moon, and then you multiply that 238,000 billion times, dimes all the way to the moon, and then you paint one of those dimes red, and you put it in those piles, and you tell somebody to go blindfolded to reach in and grab that red dime. That's the probability of the world being made without a creator. So is that mind-blowing? And that's not even convinced to tell you about what James Ferguson introduced me to a podcast this week that it was mind-blowing too. So God, I went from, as I put it, watching black and white TV in my own room to watching 4D, 4K, HD, big screen, Trombo TV this week. That Bible came alive to me when on this kind of stuff. So I thought that was, you know, every time I come up here, I'm always thinking, okay, I got to have something good to say. And I've been thinking about this for a month and had nothing until this week. And so, hey, ain't that amazing? God is good. So, all right, let's pray and we'll get started. Oh, first of all, I got to mention, if you're a visitor, welcome. I know it's kind of awkward to be a visitor, so we like to welcome you. There's a gift out back, or front, out there by the door, that you under the TV, you can sure have, and then we'll have Junior Church released after the songs are done. But now we can pray. Lord, we just thank you for this day, and we just thank you for being a great, awesome God. And you know everything that's going on in the world, explainable, unexplainable, just everything you have control of. And we just know that we can put our lives in your hands and we can follow you and we don't have to worry. So we just thank you for that. Be with us this morning and open our ears to your word. In your name, amen.
Hello, is my mic on? Everyone can hear me okay? All right, so at this year's Vacation Bible School, the Great Jungle Journey, we are going to be taking a cruise through.
Yoo-hoo! Is this where I sign up for the cruise? The cruise. I saw the flyers a little while ago, and I'm ready. After this year, I could use a nice, relaxing vacation.
I think you might be confused.
I can't wait. An all-you-can-eat buffet. The gentle lull of the beach as I fall asleep, soaking up the sun on the deck. So, when do we board?
You said you saw the flyers, right?
Of course. How else would I have known to pack for the cruise?
Oh, the Great Jungle Journey isn't an actual cruise.
Of course it is, silly. It says they're right there on the flyer, an epic cruise.
Yes, an epic cruise from Genesis through Revelation.
I don't really care where the cruise goes. Details aren't important. Would you be a dear and take my bag for me?
The Great Jungle Journey isn't a vacation cruise. It's a vacation Bible school. This year, boys and girls are going to be taking an epic cruise through Genesis to Revelation.
You're telling me that there are going to be a bunch of little kids running around on my epic cruise vacation?
No, it's not a vacation cruise. It's vacation Bible school here at church. Boys and girls will come each day for a jungle-themed adventure. They'll be cruising through time, learning the seven seas of history from the Bible, and it's happening June 2nd through the 6th.
So this isn't a luxury vacation cruise?
No, it's a vacation Bible school theme, though. The boys and girls are cruising through history, discovering more about their Creator and just how much He loves them.
Oh, well, I feel a little embarrassed now. I guess I saw the words vacation and cruise and came to the wrong conclusion.
Well, no worries. You know, you could still join us for the Great Jungle Journey. It starts Sunday, June 2nd, 5:30 to 7:30 for the whole family, then Monday through Thursday, 9 to noon for the kids, and registration is open.
I do love a good cruise. Sign me up.
Certainly. Step right this way.
Thank you, Chelsea and Mia. And after Bob's little deal, we should have sung How Great Thou Art after that little thing, Bob. But anyway, I do have a couple of quick announcements. Good thing you shut the mic off. I do have a couple of announcements to make. First of all, if you want to be baptized this summer, please come talk to me before April 28th. I would like to have a class with the baptismal candidates, but I need to know who that is, okay? Most importantly, the second announcement is the elders would like to let you know that we have a senior pastor candidate that we are excited about. We've been in contact with him a number of times over the last month through some Zoom. Sure, you can thank the Lord. You bet. I do think that we're beginning to see some of the results of our prayers, so that is a big thank you to the Lord. We've been in touch with him through Zoom contacts through the last couple months. I've talked to him personally a number of times. He grew up in the Midwest. However, it was Oklahoma. went to Oklahoma State University, but he actually spent a couple summers in Holt County putting up hay. So he's got some family in the neighborhood. But he's going to come up April 21st, so that's 2 weeks from now. And we'll give you a chance to kind of see him during our Sunday school hour that day. We will meet here, all of us, in the multipurpose room where we'll allow Dusty and Christy to talk a little bit about their lives, maybe answer some questions, and then he'll preach during the morning worship service. But anyway, thank you for praying. We know that this has been a long process, and you have been very patient throughout it. But as I said earlier, I think we're beginning to see some of the results of our prayers, and that's exciting. So April 21st, put that date on your calendar and plan to be here. All right, we're going to go into communion at this time. So first of all, we're going to sing an old familiar hymn entitled The Old Rugged Cross, and then Jamie will come up and introduce the elements to us.
Back to Exodus, when God was pronouncing judgment on the Egyptians, he sent them the 10 plagues, the last of which was the death of the firstborn son. And at that time, God provided a way of escape for the Israelites from this plague. They were to take a lamb and sacrifice it and paint the blood of this lamb on the door frames, and so they were saved. When that fateful night came, they were passed over. They were given salvation. And that event is a foreshadowing of what we got to experience later on. If you go all the way to the New Testament then, to John the Baptist, he says when he first sees Jesus, he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." And just as the Israelites trusted that blood on the doorframe, we can trust the blood of our Lamb of God that he died on the cross in our place. He provided salvation for us, just like salvation was provided for the Israelites through the sacrificial lamb. John's declaring that Jesus is our sacrificial substitutionary lamb so that we can be saved from death, just like the Israelites were way back in the book of Exodus. That's what we celebrate when it comes to communion. When it comes to communion, we remember the old rugged cross where Jesus laid down his life and shed his blood for us. We remember that he is our sacrificial lamb. We remember that he died in our place. So if you've got your communion cups, if you would open the bread side with me. On the night before he died, Jesus met with his disciples and he broke bread and he said to them, "This is my body, which is for you. Take it in remembrance of me." And then he took the cup. And he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant. Whenever you take it, do so in remembrance of me." Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that you provided a sacrificial lamb so that we could be with you for eternity. So that when we place our faith and trust in you, we can be freed from the penalty of sin. We can spend eternity in paradise with you. Lord, all because of your work on the old rugged cross. Father, we are so grateful for your love, for your grace, for your forgiveness, for your mercy. And it's all for your glory, we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Jamie.
From his reward, I
stand together as we sing The Power of the Cross.
Father, we thank you for the reminder of just what you and your son sacrificed so that we would have an eternal relationship with you. Thank you for the ability to gather together with other believers and to celebrate that with you through communion and through our weekly services, through our fellowship together throughout the week as well. I pray that you would bless the service now and open our ears to hear what you would have for us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Why don't you stay standing, say hi to your neighbors, and the little kids may go to children's church.
morning, everyone.
Good morning. Really awesome to be with you and enjoy the worship and the communion. We can never talk too much about the cross because that's where it all starts, and that's where life comes from. I want to share just before I begin, just to let you know some of the things that are happening several times, that there's some amazing things going on at college, university campuses around the country. There was a revival. Saved and baptized, and then a collegiate day of prayer, which was connected to 2,600 universities across the country, and hundreds of kids were saved at that time as well. Then I mentioned to you, I think it was a couple weeks ago, at the University of Alabama, they had 6,000 students for a night of worship and praise, and a bunch of kids were saved and baptized. I heard that the University of Georgia, they had 7,000, and a whole bunch of students were saved, and they wanted to be baptized, so they couldn't baptize them on state property. So what they did is they got four pickups together, and they baptized them. So I thought that'd be a good Nebraska story. They did whatever they needed to do, but it's so exciting to hear that, what God is doing in various places, and I hope that we hear that at the University of Nebraska and all across the country in the universities. God often begins a new work in university settings. Sometimes in the most unlikely of places, God breaks in and people come to Christ. Well, this morning we're going to return to the book of Ephesians, and we're in chapter 5, and beginning with verse 21. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21. But I got to tell you a story that my wife shared with me this week. It was about a new pastor that came into the church, and he was telling the church about, you know, he wanted to care for them, he wanted to be available. They could call him day or night, anytime, and he wanted to help in any way that he could. So one night he's sleeping, he picked it up, and there's a woman on the other end of the phone from the church. And she said, "Oh, Pastor," she said, I got terrible troubles," she said. And he says, what's the problem?" She said, "I just can't sleep." And he said, "How can I help you, ma'am?" He said, she said, "You need to start preaching." So have different effects on people. So I hope today that you don't fall asleep, all right? Five, let's pray and begin. Father, Lord, we bless you. God, all across our country, Lord, from China, there might be a great spirit of repentance and turning to you and revival, you refreshing and reviving believers and saving people and just doing it. God, Faith Community Church, and for what you're doing here. Thank you, Lord, for Dustin and Christy coming, Lord, and I pray that it would be weekend. Lord, we desire one that you'd make that increase the Holy Spirit for the word, God. What you want to say to us. And then, Lord, I just pray for each person here, for those that are having health issues. We pray for grace, for your healing presence and power, for decisions that need to be made. We pray for wisdom and discernment. Those that are had a tough week, Lord, I pray for encouragement today that together here in our time, that they would be encouraged in the faith. For some, Lord, that are still thinking about getting after Christ, maybe this day, this very day, is the one that you want to knock on their heart's door and ask for admission into life and be their Lord and Savior. Holy Spirit, so you this morning, and so I pray, help us to understand what you would have us to grasp and gain from it. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. So Ephesians chapter 5, beginning, I want to begin with verse 21. Not good. Righty, how about it now? Can you hear?
In that corner, and in the back, in this corner, all we're good. Okay. Ephesians chapter 5, beginning with verse 21.
Submitting to one another out of the reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and he himself is the Savior. Now as to the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his mother and father, hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. In the year 2024, is it possible to still have a healthy and a strong marriage? I'm going to share some thoughts with you today about God's design for marriage. I have a little experience in it, in that my wife Marge and I will be married 54 years in August, and she should have a purple heart for putting up with me with all those years. But God has blessed us. We have a long ways from a perfect marriage, but it's been a blessing in my life, I know, and I'm very grateful for it. I would highly recommend marriage, and just want to encourage each of you if you're in a marriage relationship. Now, this passage that I just read this morning, some people would say, you know, you're getting ready to walk across a landmine. This is not a popular passage to be talking about. Well, the good news is we're not interested in being popular. We're interested in trying to understand the Bible as clearly and accurately as we possibly can. And what did God really intend for us to grasp from this passage? When Jesus died on the cross, he came forth from the dead and he began a new community, which is the church, all those who would come to him for repentance and faith and new life. And then he totally began to reveal what life was going to be like as a Christian. And that would affect every area of life, from marriage to, we're getting into marriage, and then next week children, and then working in the workplace and spiritual battles. So, I mean, there's some rich teaching that's coming in the last part of the book of Ephesians. But he's talking here, it's amazing, about a husband and a wife, and that's one thing. He could just talk about that, but then he connects that to Christ in the church. He underpins that whole issue with, it's similar to Christ and how the relationship is with that. That's how it carries over into marriage. And so there's some beautiful things that he mentions here that I hope we can grasp this morning. In the first church where we pastored, we had a marriage enrichment weekend every year where we'd invite somebody to come, a well-known speaker on marriage, and would do a seminar on Saturday and then speak on Sunday. I'll never forget what the guy said. He was really excellent. He said, you know what? I have interviewed most of the most outstanding marriage counselors around the world, Christian and non-Christian. And he said, in all my interactions with them, I have never heard one good principle yet of what they said about marriage that didn't have its roots in this book. So this morning we look at one section that deals with marriage. But what he is saying is, really, all the principles of the Word of God apply to that kind of a relationship. It's not just what he directly says about marriage, but, for example, take the one another's in the Bible. There's about 40 of them, at least, where it says, you know, love one another, pray for one another, encourage one another, forgive one another, serve one another. All those things, he said, can be applied into marriage relationships. So it's not just the individual text that talks about marriage, but the Word of God is applicable in all areas. Marriage, raising children, working in a workplace, in the marketplace, wherever it is, the principles of God's Word are alive and they make a difference and they impact our lives regardless of what the situation is. So let's look at what God lays down. I want to talk about the design for marriage here this morning. First, just looking at the foundations. The four most important words in the Bible are the first four. In the beginning, God. Life starts with God, it continues with God, and it ends with God. So he's got something to say about everything. And here's what he mentions about marriage. We have to remind ourselves this morning that the institution of marriage was not started by some good marriage counselor somewhere that said, you know what, I think as a man and woman, you ought to get together and get married. Marriage was born in the heart of God. He's the one who designed it. He's the one who thought about it. He's the one who brought it to be. And he's the one who has something about how it should function, how it should be like, what it should be like. Now, it isn't exactly a surprise to say today that marriage has fallen in many ways on hard times. Sexual freedom, gender identity, open marriage, divorce, cohabitation has seriously affected our views of marriage. There was a movie a couple years ago called Monogamy. And the woman in that movie, she said this, in this country, we have kind of failed with marriage. We are so protective of this really sacred but failed institution. There's got to be a new model, she said. Well, do you not see that's exactly what our world is saying? We need a new model of marriage. We need to come up with something new because this thing doesn't work. That's her assessment of what marriage is in the contemporary society. In Scandinavia and Denmark and Sweden and Norway, where gay marriage has been legal since the early 90s, the result has been a clear decline in marriage itself. Fewer and fewer young couples even get married. They just cohabit. They might have children, and then they move on to another partner. And so the idea of marriage itself has become there. It seems passé. But this is only the most recent attack on marriage. Marriage has been under attack from the beginning. But even in our own culture, we see it. The escalating divorce rate is an attack on marriage. The idea of sexual freedom, open marriage, different things affects all of that. So what I'm saying is, you know, we're looking in a subject today that is up for grabs and redefinition in society. But I want us to come back again to the design of what God had in mind from the beginning. The devil has drawn a bullseye on marriage, and he's been pretty effective at destroying a lot of them. And so we need to continually remind ourselves, what did God have in mind for this? The Bible says that the thief, the devil, his purpose is to steal and kill and destroy. Jesus said, my purpose is to give them a rich and a satisfying life. So in the midst of all of that, in whatever goes on in culture, just like it was in the first century, the Bible comes out with a clear plan. This is what God desired and designed. So let me read some from Genesis chapter 1:31. It says, when God looked over all that he had made, he saw that it was very good, and that includes marriage. When God designed it, it was good. It still is good when it functions in the way that God desires. Now look at some other passages here from Malachi. It says, didn't the Lord make you one with your wife in body and spirit? You're his. And what does he want? Godly children from your union. So guard your heart, remain loyal to the wife of your youth, for I hate divorce, says the Lord, the God of Israel. To divorce your wife is overwhelming with cruelty, says the Lord of heaven's armies. So guard your hearts, do not be unfaithful to your wife. I've mentioned to you in the past that when God began the world, he created three institutions. The first one is marriage and family. He's the one who designed it. Second is the church. And third is the government. All three of those were God's design. And he had something to say about how each of them would function. In Genesis chapter 2, it says, then the Lord God said, it's not good for a man to be alone. I'll make him a helper who is just right for him. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while the man slept, the Lord God took out one of the man's ribs and closed up the opening. Then the Lord made a woman from the rib, and he brought her to the man. At last the man exclaimed, "This one is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she has taken from me." This explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined or is cleaved to his wife, and the two are united as one. Now the man and his wife were both naked. They felt no shame. Why? Because when you're sinless, there's no such thing as shame. So marriage is ordained of God, and he has no plan B. And so I want to encourage you, if you're married this morning, but if you're single, there's still principles about relationships. And if you have failed in a marriage and you're remarried, God works with us where we are. And as a church, we're here to do whatever we can to encourage and strengthen that marriage in a way that honors God and is a blessing to your life. So God has ordained marriage for good. He blessed it. And it's to be enjoyed and experience his presence in the middle of it. So that's just part of the foundation. Second is, a spirit-filled marriage is God's will for us. Now, it's interesting. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about life in the Spirit and about being filled with the Holy Spirit. Actually, this marriage section is connected to that, because it talks about, in verse 18, about we are not to be, don't be drunk with wine, because that'll ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, and making music to the Lord in your heart. And give thanks for everything to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and further submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. In the original, that is one long sentence that's all connected. And it starts with, be filled with the Spirit. Now, that was in the present tense, meaning it's a continual, habitual experience. Be under his influence, under his control. It's in the imperative mood, it's the command. It's also in what is called a passive voice, which means, literally, it would read, let God fill you with the Spirit. He wants to, but we have to meet some conditions. But he wants to be in control. So this being filled with the Spirit, first place that this is supposed to apply is in a marriage. It's not just individually, but it's in the marriage relationship. He wants that to be a part of that. So he says at the last part of that section there, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. In other words, what you do because of your relationship with Christ. Submit to one another. Place yourself under his authority, each of you, not only in your relationship, but also now as I'm going to ask you in your marriage to relate in this way. So I want you to submit to that teaching, to place yourself under it, to realize this is my plan for you. But the whole Christian life is about submitting. It's about yielding to Christ, submitting to him, allowing him to be Lord. We're going to follow him. We're going to obey him. We're going to serve him. We're going to worship him. We're going to witness for Christ. But we place ourselves under him. So this is really the key to the whole section. For some people this morning, you may say, you know, what world do you live in? You know, do you really expect this to be something that would be practiced in today's world? For Paul to tell wives to be subject to husbands looks to many like an unfortunate social or cultural gaffe. People who cheerfully ignore traditional morality and believe in freedom of expression suddenly become heavily moralistic and say that the passages like this are wicked and shouldn't even be read out loud. But as often as you read the Bible, there's a lot of things to be said for checking out our natural and sometimes aggressive attitude to passages that strike us as objectionable, and working through we react like this, whether we really understand the passage or not. N.T. Wright is a quotation. Then another one that he mentioned, he's a Bible scholar. He said, if this guideline seems outrageous in today's culture, we should ask ourselves, do our modern societies in which marriage is often a tragedy or a joke really offer a better model of how to do it? Does the specter of broken homes littering modern Western culture indicate that we've got it right and can tell the rest of human history we finally resolved this battle of the sexes? Or does it indicate that we still need to do some rethinking somewhere? So just a little bit of the background, that this may not be popular, but let's try to understand really the spirit and the heart of what's being said. So then God's design for women. He says, to wives, this means submit to your husbands to the Lord, for the husband's the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the savior of his body, the church. as the church submits to Christ, so you wives should submit to your husbands in everything. Now, you say, what does that mean? Well, let's break it down a little bit. And what I would say is we need to look not only at this direct text, but how does the rest of the Bible shed light possibly on what this may mean, all right? The first thing would be simply this, that for women, submission does not in any way mean inferiority, because in the eyes of God, men and women are absolutely equal, okay? We're both made in the image of God. So there's no question of superiority or inferiority. That is not what is meant in that passage at all. Because the Bible says we're made in the image of God. So that means that in order to understand the true image of God, you have to have a man and you have to have a woman. They complete the whole picture. Now, sometimes men will say, you know what? I just don't understand women. And women will say, I just don't understand men. Well, I would just say this. Guess who made us different? Where does it come from? If we're made in the image of God, it comes from the triune Godhead, all right? So there was a design, there was a purpose, there was a meaning for that. There was a reason for that. That was not accidental, that God made us different. That's to be celebrated. That's not a competition. That is to be recognized as unique, and this is the plan of God. So there's no such thing as inferiority. Women have value, dignity, and worth exactly the same level as men. We are both sinners. We can be saved by the same blood of Jesus Christ. We're indwelt by the same Holy Spirit. We have the same Word of God. We are equal in every sense. So this idea of submission, then, a man can never ask his or tell his wife, you have to submit. You don't say that because she's equal. That's a voluntary thing. She has to be willing to acknowledge that God has asked you to be a leader and that she's there to work with you and to support, but that has nothing to do with inferiority. Second, God is a God of order all through creation. You see that. There's a reason that the earth rotates around the sun, not the sun around the earth. Everything is orderly. There's a reason. Men, women, children, and government, God has a plan for all those things. There's an order to it, and that is part of what he's got here. Third, it does not mean the woman is a doormat in any way, shape, or form. There's nothing that says that means you're passive. Any man worth his salt is in a marriage relationship will talk with his wife, get her input and counsel and consideration of what's going on. You don't run off by yourself. It doesn't mean that a man sits on a throne and gives edicts about this is the way it's going to be, whatever, I'm in charge. It has nothing to do with that. Absolutely zero. That's an abuse of that. So to communicate, to be a team, to be partners, that is essential in what is made here. It does not mean that a woman is passive and she cannot use her gifts or skills or abilities or that she has nothing to say with what's going on. There are creative differences. As I said, it's not good or bad. We're physically different. We're emotionally different. We're socially different. Most women are far more verbal than men, and that's just the way life is. That's the way God intended for that to be, okay? There are differences in roles, but not in value, dignity, worth, or anything like that. Each one is a vital part of a team, and it takes both to succeed. And I think this is important for us to understand. And when you're in a marriage, one of the biggest enemies of marriage is selfishness. I want my way. She wants her way. We each want our own way. But in a marriage, it's not about me. It's about us. What's best for us is how we need to look at situations. And then he says that, especially in the last verse, he sums it up, men are to love their wives and women are to respect their husbands. That is a huge thing. A woman is called to respect her husband, to honor him, to build him up, to encourage him, to be a cheerleader, so to speak, a prayer warrior for him, and talk positively about him privately and publicly. I don't think I can emphasize that too much. That is really, really important. Now, it's kind of strange in a way that men are usually taller and physically stronger. Okay, so you think they're tough guys, right? But men are very fragile emotionally, and they need support, they need encouragement, they need respect. It's interesting, I read about a survey where hundreds of guys were asked, would you rather be alone and unloved or be in a home where you're disrespected? And you know what the vast majority said? I'd rather be alone. A man needs respect. And when we as marriage partners, when we begin to focus on the negative in our partner, I don't like the way he does this, the way he does that, the way he does that, what is that? I don't like the way she does this or that or whatever. You know, you can watch a man will just begin to shrivel. A woman has enormous power over what her man becomes by how she speaks about him, how she treats him, how she respects him, how she honors him in front of the kids, whatever it is. But that is a God-given thing, that a woman has a tremendous power to encourage her husband, to help him develop, to help him become stronger, or you can cut it down. I've seen that so many times in marriage counseling over the years, where either a man is being cut down, I mean, a woman will come in and she will start talking about her husband. Just going off about doesn't do this. I mean, everything is about him, okay? Or a woman will come in. She'll talk about her husband. Or a man will come in. He'll talk about his wife. Folks, we need to understand something. Take responsibility for your own life. The problem is not this way. The problem is not him. The problem is not her. The problem is us in our relationship. But we'll talk, next week is going to be more about, today is about kind of the design for marriage. Next week is about building the marriage, things we can do to strengthen the marriage. But this is a huge one, how we speak about each other. And I think today in our culture, you know, there have been so many things that have happened. The women's liberation movement came along and has done some really good things in that women are to be treated equal, and there's some very positive things about it. There's some very negative things about it as well. In today's culture, one of the things that really bugs me is that men today are looked at as basically worthless, okay? If you look at movies, if you look at the media, men are always the butt of jokes, always. In commercials, they usually end up being stupid. They don't catch on. They don't do this. They don't do that. There's a way of looking at young boys. They don't know what a strong male image is because they're ridiculed, they're mocked, they're made fun of. Nobody wants to be that. So what I'm saying is you never, ever get ahead by putting down one sex at the expense of the other. Women were, in many ways in history, have been mistreated and abused and taken advantage of, which is totally, categorically wrong, according to the Word of God. You don't treat people like that. But then you can't turn things upside down and say, okay, we're going to elevate women, and oftentimes it's done at the expense of men, instead of being that we're partners and that we have different roles. So, I mean, I'm just saying, you look at society, and you see it everywhere. I mean, it's just so pervasive that men, you don't need a man. You see books about that. Why do you need a man? If you want a baby, go to the sperm bank and you can get your baby. You don't need a guy around. They're worthless. They're no-shows. Well, listen, there are some men that are not great, okay? But there also are some women that are not great. Let's be honest. We can share in our sins. Nobody's up here and one's down here. No, we're all fellow sinners, men and women. So let's get that straight. Do we understand that? But we don't need to pick each other apart. I'm going to talk more about that next week, that the power to focus on the negative in a relationship is absolutely destructive. And what it's the message it sends to our kids about how we function in the home. What's the role of the man? Is the man respected? Is the woman loved and cherished and valued? Or are we in this competitive role where we constantly have to put one up or one down? Something has to happen. That is wrong, and there's nothing healthy about it. Let me just share with you a story that I came across from Kathy Keller. Tim Keller was, I consider, one of the best Bible teachers that we had in the last century. He passed away about a year ago, or maybe a little bit more. But she talks about her relationship with her husband. In the late 1980s, our family was comfortably situated in a very livable suburb of Philadelphia, where Tim held a full-time position as a professor. Then he got an offer to move to New York City to plant a new church. He was excited by the idea, but I was appalled. Raising our three wild boys in Manhattan, New York, was unthinkable. Not only that, but almost no one who knew anything about Manhattan thought that the project would be successful. I also knew that this would not be something that Tim would be able to do as a 9-to-5 job. It would absorb the whole family and nearly all of our time. It was clear to me that Tim wanted to take the call, but I had serious doubts that it was the right choice. I expressed my strong doubts to him, and he responded, "Well, if you don't want to go, then we won't go." However, I replied, "Oh, no, you don't. You're not putting that decision on me. That's abdication. If you think this is the right thing to do, then exercise your leadership and make the choice. It's your job to break this logjam. It's my job to wrestle with God until I can fully support your call." Tim made the decision to go to New York City and plant Redeemer Church. The whole family, my sons included, consider it one of the most important decisions Dad ever made, because he was quite scared, but he felt that God called him. At that point, Tim and I were both submitting to roles that we're not perfectly comfortable with, but it is clear that God worked in us and through us when he accepted our gender roles as a gift from the designer of our hearts. So she said, she made her wishes known, how she felt about it. But she said, "If you feel God has called you, you let me wrestle with God, but I'm going to respect you to make the decision. You're to be the leader." And he did. Obviously, this turned out really well as he planted a church there right in the heart of New York City. And we've been to that church. There were like 5,000 people. That church had an impact all around the world for Christianity, and their family did well. But it just was an example of a situation where they talked freely about it. They didn't agree, but in the end, they said, "Okay, God, if that's what you have, we're going to do it." And they ended up doing it. So the women's role is extremely important in a home, and one of them is to respect her husband and to seek to encourage and to build him up. Then God's design for men. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the savior of the body of the church. In other words, again, you do what you do, men, because of Christ. Women, you do what you do because of Christ. It's tied inseparably to a relationship with Jesus Christ. Husbands, this means you love your wives as Christ loved the church. He gave up his life to her to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. He did this to present to himself as a glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she would be holy and without fault. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives, they love their own bodies. For a man who loves his wife actually shows love for himself. No one hates his own body, but feeds and cares for it, just as Christ cares for the church, and we are members of his body. As the scripture says, a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. This is a great mystery, but it's an illustration of the way Christ and the church are one. So again, I say to each man, you must love his wife as he loves himself, and his wife must respect her husband. Now, it's interesting here, guys. In this passage, there are 3 verses to women, and there are 8 verses to men. So it's not like we came out, you know, we're supposed to be the head of the home and this kind of stuff, and we came out with nothing. We've got 8 verses to say, men, here's what you're supposed to do. We are supposed to love our wives. Now, what's interesting is you have to understand, again, the context in which this is written. Okay, it's very, very important. The Jewish life and the Greeks, those were the two dominant ones. Now, the Jews had a very low view of women. In the morning prayer, there was a sentence in which the Jewish man gives thanks to God that he has not made him a Gentile, a slave, or a woman. In Jewish law, a woman was not a person, but a thing. She had no legal rights whatsoever. In the Greek culture, Demosthenes had laid it down as the accepted rule of life. We have courtesans, which are prostitutes, for the sake of pleasure. We have concubines for the sake of daily cohabitation. We have wives for the purpose of having children legitimately and having a faithful guardian of all our household affairs. The women of the respectable classes in Greece led completely secluded lives. Now, that's the background in which this was given. So what did Paul say? Did he throw the baby out with the bathwater? No. He said, men, you're to be the head of the home, but in a completely, radically different way than what was happening with Jewish and Greek life. He redefined the whole thing. And in order for this not to be abusive, like what it had been, he tells the man, you're supposed to treat your wife with respect and love and dignity. And the word love, agape love, simply means seek her highest good. Always. You do not treat her in a way that she's been treated in culture. You are superior in the way that you treat her. You treat her my way. You show your love like I love the church, which is a sacrificial love. And men, just like women, have a lot to do with the way the man develops in a relationship. Men, we have a lot to do with how our wives develop. Do we care for them? Do we look after their interests? Do we love them, tell them we love them, show them we love them, and we're committed to helping them achieve their highest, whatever the talents, gifts, and abilities, we want to bring them out. We want to nurture them. We want to strengthen them. We don't put them down. We don't use them. We treat them with dignity, with respect. That's radically new in culture in the first century, and that's radically new for the 21st century. So God's way is always superior. In whatever issue he talks to, God's ways are higher than anybody else. The woman in that movie said, I think we need a new model. No, we need the old model practiced in a new way is what we need. We need it applied the way God intended originally. There's nothing that's needed that's new at all. Because if that happens, there's going to be a lot of love and harmony in the family to make sure her needs are met. We're not macho men. We're not chauvinists. We don't give out the orders, but we lead in the sense that we have responsibility for this, for our wives and for our children, if we have children. This is our little flock. We look after their interests. That's how we operate. If we are spirit-filled husbands and spirit-filled wives, there's going to be beautiful work. None of us are perfect. We have to continue to work at it. I would just say, men, there's three ways in history that we have responded. Number one is abusive, and that's what I read to you about the Jewish culture and about the Greeks. That was abusive, domineering, totally wrong. Second, and this is a huge factor with a lot of men, which is really, really sad, and that is a lot of men are passive, very passive. And that is just totally bad news. If a man is passive in his relationship, in his marriage, or with his children. And a lot of guys are aggressive in the marketplace. They can just really, really do well. But when it comes to the home life, it's kind of like, well, that's, you know, my wife can take care of that. That's wrong. We as men should be intentional. We should be engaged in what's going on in our wife's life. See, the ideal is that as a man, I need to become a student of my wife. My wife is unique. I need to understand her. I need to understand what's going on in her life. How can I come alongside? How can I help? How can I do this? How can I bring out the best in her? And the same thing with a woman. This is my husband. This is my man. I need to study him. I need to try to understand him and how I can be a blessing to him. You know, our marriage is a good marriage, but it's not a perfect marriage. My wife married a sinner, okay? But I want to tell you, The one desire that I have in my life, not only as a pastor, but as a husband and a father, was I want to be a good husband, and I want to be a good father and a grandfather. And we just found out we're going to be great grandparents. So whatever the situation, Lord, I want to be good in the home. You know, we're getting ready to select elders in the church, which is a really, really, I thank God for the men we have in our church that are really good, godly men. You know what the Bible says where you find the first place you look for leadership? in the home. How a man treats his wife, his relationship with his kids, not if he's the CEO of a huge company and a $40 billion business, but how does he relate to his family? What's he do? Now, none of us are perfect, okay? We're a work in progress, all of us. But it just underscores, Howard Hendricks used to be a great Bible teacher who passed away. He always said, if your faith doesn't work in your home life, don't export it. In other words, this is the place where you try it out. That's the toughest place. Pretty easy to be a Christian in church, really easy. But it's, man, when you're tired and you're stressed out and you're going through this and that and whatever, what's it like in the home life? That's what he wants to know. That's where Christianity really takes root. Let it flourish there and let it go out from there. And so, if this passage is understood right, it's a beautiful picture. You know, I've counseled many couples over the years, like I said, it's all, usually in a counsel, in a marriage, we get tunnel vision, you know. I think the problem is her. I think the problem is him. I'll ask them. You know, you've been married 15 years. How do you feel about what you've created? They kind of look, what do you mean? Well, it's your marriage, right? It is what it is. The marriage that you and I have today, it's what, by the grace of God, we have created. We can't blame this one. No, it's us. This is what we have done since we have been together. Let me share a wonderful story with you. Years ago, we'd have missions conference in our church, and we'd always have a mission speaker in. And we had a gentleman by the name of Robertson McQuilkin. He was the president of Columbia Bible College and Seminary. And his wife had the beginning of Alzheimer's. And they came to our church, and he says, all right, if I bring her along? He said, absolutely. So she came. We had him over for lunch in our house after the service, and delightful people. And she was a vivacious woman. She had her own radio program. She had a TV program. She spoke at conferences. She was an artist. I mean, she did a ton of things. But she asked, you know, Marge, can I help you getting the food ready? And I think Marge, if I remember, suggested you could help with the salad if you like. So she started making the salad, and then she just walked away and forgot what she was doing. That was just part of what was going on. But here's what happened. As she had her Alzheimer's, she needed more and more of me, and I wrestled daily with the question of who gets me full-time, Muriel or Columbia Bible College and Seminary. Dr. Tabor, their medical doctor, advised me not to make any decisions based on my desire to see Muriel stay contented. Make your plans apart from that question, whether or not you can be successful in your dreams for the college and seminary or not. I can't judge, but I can tell you, you will not be successful with Muriel. When the time came, the decision was firm. It took no great calculation. It was a matter of integrity. Had I not promised 42 years before, in sickness and in health, till death do us part? There was no grim duty to which I stoically resigned. However, it was only fair. She had, after all, cared for me for almost four decades with marvelous devotion. Now it was my turn. And such a partner she was. She took care of me for 40 years, and I would never be out of her debt. But how could I walk away from the responsibility of a ministry God had blessed so signally during our 22 years at Columbia Bible College and Seminary? And so, to make a long story short, he resigned, and he went home, and he took care of her for 12 years. He said, I have been startled by the response to the announcement of my resignation. Husbands and wives renew marriage vows. Pastors tell this story to their congregation. It was a mystery to me until a distinguished oncologist who lives constantly with dying people told me, almost all women stand by their men. Very few men stand by their women. Perhaps people sensed this contemporary tragedy, and somehow we helped by a simple choice I considered as the only option. It was an incredible story of his love for his wife that he resigned at 57, and he was almost at the peak of his career, But he said, I'm going to go home, and I'm going to love and care for Muriel until she died. And he did. We have heard of a person that was in a church that we were at earlier, and she died this week. And her husband were married for 64 years. When we started ministry there, about a year after we got there, they decided they were going to divorce. And so they did. They got a divorce. Kind of stayed in touch with them. And a year later, one day, he called me and he said, could you come to our house? We want to renew our vows and we want to get married again. And so I did. And they got remarried and they lived for another 42 years and had a wonderful life. I know of another couple that was separated, divorced for 7 years and got back, and they're still happily married today. See, one of the amazing things about marriage, a Christian marriage, is the same thing with the church. There are churches that are dead in the water. But God, when he comes to revive them, guess what? They get new life. And God can renew marriages. Maybe you're struggling this morning. You say, man, our marriage is just not what it needs to be. And that's the first step, is to recognize, you know what? We're not creating. I don't like what we're building. We need to change some things here. We'll talk more about that next week. But God in his grace can renew and refresh. That's the plan that God has for us. And then the flip side of sad story is I know two couples that celebrated their 50th anniversary, 50 years together. And within that next year, they both divorced. So, you see, marriage is a living organism. It requires attention. It requires input. It requires sacrifice. It requires us, not me. Too many partners are concerned about me. I'm not happy. I'm not getting my needs met. I know it takes two. I understand that. But it's about us and what we create and what we want to do, and God's willing to work with us. Great marriages don't happen by luck or by accident. They are the result of consistent investment of time, thoughtfulness, forgiveness, affection, prayer, mutual respect, and a rock-solid commitment between a husband and a wife. I just think it's amazing that God lays this out, and then how he connects this with the church in Christ. It's just amazing. He said, our marriages are supposed to mirror what Christ in the church is, this loving, caring, compassionate Jesus, how he cares for us individually. He says, that's how we're supposed to be. It's a place of respect. It's a place of love. It's a mystery. It's a mystery. But God wants us to have healthy marriages. And if we don't, we can work at things. But by the grace of God, he can bring about some amazing things. Let's pray. Father, thank you for today. Thank you, Jesus, for your plans. Thank you that we don't need anything new. We just need to obey you and do what you call us to do. God, I pray for those that may be hurting today. I pray for hope. I pray for encouragement. I pray for strength. I pray for healing. But I pray for a passion to do what you call us to do so that we can build a happy, healthy marriage for the glory of God and the good of our relationship, Lord. Thanks. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise.
what Mike has been talking about. And marriage is about us, not about me. And ultimately, it's about me submitting to him and asking him to impact the way I live in relationship with my spouse. Have a good week, folks. Thanks for coming out.